Georgia area throughout Georgia, none other than Senator David Lucas, the senior senator for the Bibb County delegation, in my opinion, the senior, the dean of all the legislators probably in the state of Georgia. Welcome, Senator, to our program.
Glad to be here.
Well, good to see you. You know, you just got through with a, another session, and I guess this will be your 35th session or what have you, but you just finished a session. How would you rate this session to other session in terms of you came out of an election year, but in terms of things getting done, legislation that mattered to the people?
I rated a D minus.
And that's coming out off of one that probably got an F before with all the suppression of voters and all that stuff that went on. But some of the things that did happen this year, I understand you put more money in education, and you own the Appropriation Committee.
Right.
Did you all put more money in education, but yet I understand they want to take money out of the governor vetoed something, take it out of the university system. How did that work?
Well, you know, I hadn't looked at the list that he vetoed, but if he vetoed some money taken out of the university system, it probably got $105 million that was put in for Wellstar, who closed two hospitals in Atlanta and getting ready to build one down in Columbia County, and also cut a deal with the Medical College of Georgia, and that was to integrate their entire system with the computer system of Medical College of Georgia before they cut the deal. And so in supplemental, that was $105 million put in to make that happen. So I would assume that if the government vetoed something, that $105 million.
Now, you have been a big proponent of rural health care and Mercy University's College of Medicine, and by extension, Morehouse School of Medicine. Why has that always been so important to you to make sure that these institutions are funded and these rural hospitals are?
Well, you know, for 37 years I was an urban legislator, and then when I got into the Senate, I had rural counties. And when you look at Hancock County, who had one of the worst health outcomes for a community and no hospital, then folks needed help. And, you know, the problem, when I first started trying to do it, I went to Morehouse. And I couldn't get any help from Morehouse. That's how I ended up with Mercy. I went and met with the president and told him what my problems were and I needed help. And he agreed to do it. So when Dr. Sumner came over, you know, I talked to her about it. And she started looking at ways of how we could develop health care in rural Georgia. Tell them us. They do it with folks in Guatemala, you know, on a screen and a computer. And so we did the same thing out of Hancock County. We had television screens that were put on the ambulance, monitored, and we had it connected to the emergency room in Putnam County, that kind of thing. And we had a lady that had problems. She was in a cul-de-sac down a hill. They got on the gurney, got up to the highway, and then they had the emergency room physicians examine her on the screen, and she was having a stroke. And so the doctor told them what to do as they were en route to the hospital. Then all of a sudden, the machine got tore up. The cameras and everything were locked. It was covered up. And that was because the politics in Hancock County and the chairman of the county commission got mad with me because I reapportioned Hancock County after it had never been reapportioned in 20 years. And she was serving in the general secretary and didn't do it. And they just tore up and messed up the program. But the telemedicine has taken off. But Mercy is doing it all over the state of Georgia. They had in Harris County, I think there were about 1,300, 1,500 school kids up there with no health care. They went up there and did a program there. They redid the program down in Sumter County, in America, Georgia, where Jimmy Carter is. That mission was to put doctors in rural Georgia. And right now they are fulfilling that mission. Mm-hmm. And so I don't mind helping them because I have no health problems that one individual needs to have. I had them, and because I was here in the metropolitan area of Macon, within 15 minutes, either way, I could be in the hospital. And so those kind of opportunities are not afforded in rural Georgia. You know, you have to either call somebody, and for well and good, they're a helicopter. But it's raining, they got to get out of it, drive better, 45 minutes, try to get you somewhere to save you. That's what healthcare is all about. And then healthcare ought to be mandated. It ought to be mandated. We in a country that ought not to have healthcare problems. Hmm.
Yeah. Did we make any progress at all on expanding Medicaid? And was there a conversation about it?
We did not have a conversation about it whatsoever. The expansion of Medicaid has been a policy decision. And it's political. That came about because President Obama did the Affordable Health Care Act. And for some reason, they've had a problem with it. But now, folks like Mitch McConnell in Kentucky, they accepted expanded Medicaid. Mm. So our dollars in Georgia are going to other places outside of Georgia rather than coming here.
And this doesn't make sense.
We got over half a million folks that's uninsured in Georgia. I mean, we did one thing, we passed a bill that lowered the insulin cost, just like they did.
Yeah, that was
nice. No. That was only on Medicaid and Medicare.
Okay.
We did it for health.
But what I mean, it was
Georgia health benefit.
Okay.
The plan, our health care plan. So they kept the cost on that. But, you know, we had all kinds of things. We had a bill to deal with DA that the General Assembly would determine whether or not a DA was doing their job. And if they didn't like it, they could replace the DA. Now, nobody said anything about that bill when the folks down in Brunswick, Georgia, with Ahmaud Arbery, didn't do the prosecution, and the governor had to send a special prosecutor down there to do the DA. And all of a sudden, this comes up. But it's all about Trumpism.
You think the state has just gone red, gone crazy? And when I say crazy, I'm not going to call people crazy, but and when I say crazy, I use that as you're familiar in terms of so locked in with Trumpism that they can't see anything.
There's no question about it. There's no question about it.
What does that leave us as a state, as a progressive? We're one of the most progressive, because of Atlanta and Macon and Savannah. We have, on the one hand, seen as a very progressive state with major league football and basketball and everything else. But then on the other hand, we act like we're Mississippi sometimes.
Well, you know, we've got folks that Trump brought it on that believe because of their skin color, they can do whatever they want to do with no consequences. And in the General Assembly, Republicans, about folks having babies, but they don't want to take care of when they're born. They want to run every spectrum of your life. In other words, we say you got to do this, and they got the numbers to do it. But so it's like elections will have consequences.
Let's talk about education. Another thing that you've been big on, you know, from a boy, your father was an educator, you an educator, your wife is an educator, you educated sons and daughters in the public school system. But on the agenda this time was about vouchers, taking money out of the public school system, giving it to that didn't pass.
I think it's so many bills that the country I forget.
But I mean, the majority,
They couldn't get enough votes to do something in them, and they didn't want it either.
Oh, I was wondering about that. What was the politics of
that? Yeah, if they had to ask some of them, you know, anytime it takes a constitutional majority, then they have to have a Democrat, because they do not have the numbers where they can just run some by as a constitutional amendment without it.
Is that what happened to the gambling, the sports betting, and sports
betting?
Well,
is that what happened to that as well? That thing ended up. You had one, the dealing with sports betting, and then you had people who were casinos, then you had people who were horse racing. Well, part of the problem with the horse racing bill, which failed, was they didn't come talk to any of the folks in the Democratic caucus about doing nothing. They just put a bill together and said, we're going to pass it. And so what we did, well, y'all didn't talk to us. We got no man put it into it, so they had with it. And we didn't vote for it, so it failed. And then when the sports betting bill came up, we had put things in, like a scholarship for kids in rural counties, those kind of
based on need.
And then all of a sudden, somebody came up and put an amendment to strip that out to say, well, it's already in the law. We don't need that. Well, when they did that, that was the cold word for them to vote against the sports betting bill. And so it did not pass. And so the politics in legislatures, where you have Republicans, has got to the point that I call Trumpism. We do as we want, and we outvote you. We don't care about what you're talking about.
So you're saying that if you're a Democrat and a minority party, it's hard to build a coalition to get anything done that you want to have.
You got to be able to get some. For instance, we had problems at the crime lab here in Macon. We lost our medical examiner, David Tyler. Well, to get a forensic pathologist, they're waiting to go. In other words, everybody's trying to get them, so the salary is committed. Well, I'm getting phone calls at 10 o'clock at night from the film director saying, look, we got this person out 3 weeks, can't get a certificate. Well, anytime there's a homicide, that has to be an autopsy. So that might take you 3 weeks to get all of that done. And so what I was able to do was convince my folks on the appropriations that we need to get this deal done. And so we ended up at the beginning of April. The chief eye director, who appoints the chief medical examiner, they agreed that starting April 1st, we'd be fully staffed. And that's what we are. We put about $2.5 million in the budget on bonds that haven't been sold in case we need to get some extra equipment there and everything. But now we are fully staffed out that way. We want folks don't have to jump up and run all the way to Atlanta. And if you're in South Georgia, you gotta leave both that in the morning to get to Atlanta for the plan to last closed to get them out of here. But my biggest deal is probably now when we start looking at elections, somehow we have forgotten about how we got folks that look like me and you to be in elected office. It took people dying, so folks got lynched, just for the privilege of being able to cast the ballot. In the last general election, there were 30,000 blacks on the book who did not vote in Macon. And we want to know what's going on. When you look at the county government, I went for consolidation because I knew what it was all about. It was about reducing the number of folks who look like me being able to represent their folks and have a vote. Now you got consolidation. You got 9 folks. And it's majority white. And in one of the seats, bidding seats, a guy by the name of Seth Clark won it. He all right. But when they have things on the commission, it's a 5-4 vote. So they don't have to do much discussion. If they got the vote, they can do what they want to do. And my problem is we fail to realize that elections have consequences. When you did a consolidation deal and you put term limits in, there aren't but so many of us who will run and let our life be out there in the public open. And then, of course, those who look like us talking about running, they don't need to be scared for it. You know, if you're scared, let us know you're scared so we know not to elect you. Because this is about real change, and it is about the business. Well, about when you were the mayor, we started getting houses in black neighborhoods, building houses back in our community. And when you left, Rick did all downtown. He came about the community. It was all downtown. Now, with this man, he's doing what commissioners had asked Rick to do back then. He's doing it. He's tearing down these houses that black folks are calling them back. That's because they tried to keep that property up, and here's a regular house over here that just got burned down, and those kind of things. But it still is about the Benjamins. And how do you get to the Benjamins? By elected officials. The elected officials pass laws. The general public influenced them, and they influenced by elected those of us who then make the law. Yeah. But our problem be a county, and we just gave it up.
Let's talk about Bibb County in education and private schools now. We have Ace Academy.
Yeah.
I understand it's a very good school, one of the tops.
It's a public private school, that's all it is.
Yes, but it's located, as you said, located in a city that's predominantly African American, but yet I understand only 30% of the population, but yet a $30 million bond from the Urban Development Authority. So how could we have made sure that that school is more equitable in terms of enrollment, would be able to look more like the county than it is?
The school ain't going to look like the county. They kick them out. They kick them out. They make it hard for blacks to go there. Unless people got all the wherewithal and all of the, they make it hard.
Because you don't get no transportation, number one.
No,
you got to have a car to get your child there. Any activities, no bus to bring them home.
Yeah.
So it just puts up all those barriers. Yeah. And where it was located in the county in the first place, where almost in the Monroe County.
It's a private school, basically.
But it's a state charter school.
They were a public charter school in Bibb County first. When they started doing stuff, they all of a sudden went and got a state charter.
Which the Board of Education had to sign, the local board had to sign off on it, I understand.
No, the local board signed off on the original school. The state signed off with eight on the state charter.
All right, but we're still, I just hope that school will doing so well, and we commend them for doing well, but we would like to have more people have
access that ain't going to happen. I'm telling you, it's about the business. And the problem is, we got to get off our behind. And we got to vote. How many went this week? The mayor is white. The mayor pro tem. The chairman of the water authority is white, but this county is 63% black. The sheriff is white.
Tax commission
is white, but we 63%. We are 63%.
So the power is there.
And guess what? They Republicans are standing trying to prohibit you. I mean, I'm looking where these states now have made it illegal for students to use student ID to register where they're in school at.
Let's talk about one thing before we leave, and that is we want to talk about the Soul Jam that's coming up. We definitely want people to come and support you because you support this community in so many ways, and you deserve a lot of support. But let's talk about the Constitution of this state. It says that all tax money coming from gas must only go to roads and bridges. So on the one hand, now the state is promoting electronic vehicles. Won't be any gas taxes, but yet I understand now you want to turn around, not you, but the powers that be in the legislature, want to create a tax that you pay for your electric vehicles with.
Well, I'm fine. I'm just being honest. What you got to do, if it's an electric vehicle, they use the same as old, but they ain't paying no taxes. So what we did was,
well, does the money still go where the gas tax went?
What the bill did was basically calculated what the gas would be versus a kilowatt hour. And that's how they determined how much these electric vehicles would have to pay. Now, the part of the problem is, how do you gauge? Because, you know, Tesla had their own thing where they charge their cars and everything. Part of the problem was, would they be able to go direct sales rather than set up a dealership? And we did not agree to that. And deal problem, but one of the problems is, if you were dealing with direct sales, something happened to your car, who are you going to call? Where are you going to get it fixed at? That's what a dealer is supposed to do. When you buy a car from them, they pay for it and everything. So we had to come up with a way to try to look at how we're going to supplant that electricity in the highways. Because the electric vehicles only have like $300 on taxes on it. But now you got electricity. Now, part of the problem with that is that when you have blackout, just say if you stay in a neighborhood that's being affluent, everybody got electric cars. They come over at 5 o'clock and they plug the car. There's something going to give. Somebody's house going to blank or something. So the power grid has to be able to handle all of that. So, you know, Georgia Power said they can do it. They got the infrastructure to do it. They can provide the power. Fine. But what we have to look at is these roads. Let's talk. The harbor in Savannah. We just built that bridge. That bridge ain't 17 years old. And it's still hidden. And now we're talking about being the one higher than that.
So the money goes to roads and bridges, and we understand by Constitution. But would it make sense for the new EV money or the new tax money to be expanded to mass transit? Because we got a lot of people, like here, they're trying to raise the fees for poor people. Isn't it about time to put some of that money into mass transportation?
Well, you know, we put money in mass transit, and of course, you know, with all of the money that came out of these cities because of COVID and all of those things. But the problem in making money, why would you raise the fees when 20% of folks can make a loan out of car?
And the poverty rate is very high.
And the poverty rate is very high, with no chance of looking for an increase. But you get all this federal money. And see, that's the reason I say let's have consequences. Because look at who's on that transit board, who will go out and make that decision that we're going to raise the price on these folks. You got to have folks who've been involved in the community that know a little something. Or if they don't know, they can pick up the phone and call somebody. Yeah, what y'all think about this?
Well, we are speaking with Senator David Lucas, and of course, he's been around the block a couple of days, 37 years in the legislature. Did you serve with President Carter?
No. I was the first intern on Jimmy Carter's intern program to be elected to the Georgia General Assembly.
So you worked in the capital while he was
I got an internship at the governor's office, and I worked at the YBC.
Oh, okay. But out of the Carter administration. Have you had the, I know you spoke about the, what he's doing out in Plains. Have you had an opportunity to see him or speak with him since he's gone?
No, I talked to him years past, but I've not had the opportunity to speak to him, I guess within the last 10 years.
Let's talk about we have 2 minutes left, let's talk about Soul Jam. This is something that you, Soul Jam, for those of you that, if you don't know, it's a, and to be the smallest, but now you know, it's a Memorial Day celebration always at Henderson Stadium.
Right, it's a Sunday before Henderson Stadium. Soul Jam started because folks came to me when I first got there. Why we always got to go to that decision? And so, I got the guys who were doing the show called Flashback in Atlanta, degree to come to make a judge. They would do Flashback that Saturday, we'd do Flashback that Sunday. After 5 years, they said, we're not going to make money out of coming to make an agreement. And they pulled out. I went to Brother Stewart, never was a kid, at Budweiser. Brother and I have been knowing each other ever since I was 24 years old. And I talked to him about it, and he agreed. He said, "Dave, I'm gonna give you enough money to start the thing for 2 years, and then I'm gonna cut it in half." And what he said was, "He's gonna give me an opportunity to get some more sponsors involved." Now, so damn, when the folks realized that it cost a lot of money, you're talking about almost $95,000 when you get through. Paying the act, the hotel room, the transportation, feeding the venue, the insurance on the venue, the insurance on all. Look, you're talking about real money. And then everybody knows you. But, I mean, who's going to come help me pay that bill if I don't get enough folks out
there? It would be on Memorial Day weekend.
No, it would be that Sunday before.
Sunday before.
Memorial Day.
Which is the weekend. Give us briefly who some of the talent and how what it cost to get in.
All right, the talent is Midnight Star, Heat Wave, J1, West Love and Stan Butler, David Lucas and the Soul Jam Band, John Dunn and the Jazz Went Out of Athens, and Big Mike and the Booty Bounce.
Bring your bottles in, but no guns.
You can bring your libation, your food, everything. No glass bottles. We do such cool.
And no weapons.
No weapons. We search cool in case somebody fighting by being split and putting the pistol in a plastic bag.
So you have a lot of security.
We have off duty, being kind of sheriff.
In uniform.
Check his bag to make sure. Checking the ice chest to make sure nobody's bringing a weapon in. One of the things, excuse me, we got folks that are 70 or 80 years old. And I'm sitting in the Cleveland apartment. And I can't run like I used to. Can't even jump. And so what we want folks to do is to have a good time.
Clean family fun.
A lot of folks have made family reunions out of it. This is not a kid show. And we don't have any kid tickets.
Okay.
So it's $45 in advance. It's $50 at the gate. You get your early bird ticket at the Grand Opera House for $35, plus whatever the service charge is. But one of the problems with that is, who are you in front of? How many folks do you get? And that's how you sell the advertising to the folks that you call your sponsors. Who am I giving my name? How many folks I'm giving my name in front of? Right. And so that's the reason I was surprised the other day that they tell me they cut me $5,000 from AT&T. And so I'm going to have to look at AT&T. I got my phone service with AT&T, but I'm going to have to look at them.
Well, we know that you can persuade them to get back up. But we thank you for what you do, not only for us as a constituent, but what you do for the community at large in terms of this show, because this is great entertainment. Like you said, people are going to go to Atlanta. Good, clean, fun. And I'm sure you take a lot of those proceeds and give it back into different organizations.
Oh, yeah.
So we appreciate you. We've been speaking with Senator David Lucas, who is the senior representative representing Macon, Bibb County, and several other counties in the state legislature, and the proprietor, if you will, of Soul Jam Fest. And this is what year is this? 21?
If you take 5 years away that we were doing it as flashback, and now you go to Soul Jam, we're talking about 27 years.
27 years, that's a long time. He deserves my support. Thank you all so much for watching here on the Village Radio Spotlight. First time to look at